We all live in a digital world. We all need it to be open and safe. We all want to trust.
And to be trusted.
We all despise control.
And desire freedom.
We are all united.
Everyone, this is Anya from the IGF Secretariat. In my capacity as the focal point for the National, Regional, and Youth IGFs. And it's a pleasure to be here and so wonderful to see so many of you in person. This session is not moderated by me, but someone that's much, much better than me, Ms. Jane Coffin. I'm sure that her name does not need any additional introduction. So let me please immediately hand over to Jane to explain. Just a very brief note before Jane takes the floor that this session has been prepared in a bottom-up manner by a number of national, regional, and youth IGFs. Many of them are present here in person, and a bigger number is present online. With that, Jane, please take it from here, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Anya. You've done a wonderful job in organizing the session. It's great to see people there. And Katowice, my apologies for not being there, but it's excellent to see this hybrid format working so well. The NRIs are very, very important to global connectivity, to global inclusion, expanding digital inclusion, and a core part of the IGF. We have the pleasure today of having several speakers that will speak for about a minute each about the importance of what they're doing at the NRI level. I'd like to take a second, though, to reflect on the fact that there have been so many global changes in the ecosystem over the last couple of years, and this will filter down into all of the work that people are doing at the NRI level. Of course, I would be a bit remiss if I didn't mention that COVID has, of course, shown us the importance of connectivity. It has shown us the importance of digital inclusion and what that means to every different locality. It has shown us that governments have to work together across ministries. It has shown us the power of the private sector, the civil society, the technical communities, and how much we can do when we work together. And again, when we listen to people at the local level, because it's the local communities that know how to bring more connectivity, how to create better digital inclusion and equity in their local areas. And we must figure out ways to work together. It is about partnership, and no partner should be a single point of failure. So at the global level, when we see LEOs being rolled out, more submarine cable systems being deployed, communities and countries changing and embracing community networks, hooray, and building out more connectivity, we see the opportunities in front of us for change. And it's that importance of working together at the local levels. I'm going to turn over. We're going to have a series of speakers here. And then after that, we're going to have a reflection on what the open floor has said. So first, it's we have a speaker from Tanzania, Ms. Catherine Kimambo. She's a coordinator for one of the NRIs, and she's talking a bit about Basic Internet Foundation. She's on site there in Katowice. So Catherine, it's over to you to speak, and I believe you have a minute for a reflection.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Catherine Richard Kimambo. I'm from Tanzania. I represent a foundation called Basic Internet Foundation, available in Norway, Oslo. So we work in 13 different countries in Africa, and Tanzania being one among them. We work on programs on school connectivity mostly, and we have a contract with Vodacom Foundation and other telecom operators to connect schools. Yes, thank you, Jen, but I would really agree with what you're saying, that indeed it's that COVID is the one that showed the importance of digital inclusion in this time and era, because after the COVID pandemic, that's when the government really saw the importance of connecting schools. And that's when we got our first contract signed by the government to deploy school connectivity project. But before that, we had faced a lot of challenges in terms of policy, getting the partners in place, and having people understand the need for connectivity. So I agree with what you're saying, and I believe it's very important to have initiatives like From at a local level, and partnerships are really important. So what we do in Basic Intern Foundation, we really advocacy for partnership in a local level and international level. We are working with content creators, we work with people on digital skills, we are working with the government and mobile network operators. So we are on a multi stakeholder engagement, trying to see how everyone can come on board in making sure that we are leaving no one behind. So thank you.
Thank you very, very much. The next speaker is coming to us from Ghana, Ghana IGF. We have the Honorable Samuel Nate George. He's a member of the National Parliament, Republic of Ghana, and he is on site. Over to you.
Yeah, hello. Hi. Unfortunately, I'm not on site. I am actually unable to travel. We are having issues with our budgets in Ghana, and so we haven't been able to join. But I'll just share a few words with you on the impact of COVID and what that's done for us as a country with connecting schools and what that has helped us to do. COVID has been a big eye-opener, just like as the previous speaker said, in Tanzania. We had a program where we already started a connectivity of schools. But what COVID did for us was to draw their attention and make this a front burner issue. It was no longer seen as a luxury. It was seen as a necessity where we had to use internet connectivity to connect schools. But even in our case, we realized that there were areas in the country where it wasn't just about internet connectivity, but we need to now begin to develop TV white spaces. When you do the digital migration, to be able to use this TV white spaces, to be able to reach hard to reach areas where internet connectivity and penetration doesn't exist. So that, because we've got islands and communities in Ghana that are cut off from the national grid. And so this has brought all of those conversations, the use of TV white spaces and aerial fiber that run on grid, electricity grid lines, and how we can create an integrated network that would allow us leave nobody behind. It's also helped us accelerate our last mile connectivity project, where we have in Ghana, we have the major national fiber backbones that run our Western Corridor, Eastern Corridor fiber networks, but they have never really been connected to the small communities along the road. It's always the main district capitals. So what this has done is it's actually brought to the fore the need for us to look at last mile connectivity to ensure that no one is left behind. And I think that that's a major thing that we need to begin to look at. It's easy to talk about internet penetration as developing countries and say we've connected our major cities and our major district capitals, but then there are people in the rural areas and we cannot afford to leave them behind. And I think that that's one thing we need to look at. Thank you.
Thank you. And this is such an important point about not leaving behind the rural and remote areas. I'm in a rural area right now and I hear you. The next speaker up is Cote d'Ivoire, Ms. Gertrude Kone Kwasi. She's the executive director of the National Union of Telecommunications Companies. Over to you, Ms. Gertrude. We're interested in hearing your points and perspectives.
Bonjour à tous. Je suis désolée de parler en français, mais je m'exprime mieux en français qu'en anglais. Et je suis contente d'être avec vous aujourd'hui pour partager la réflexion sur la connectivité, sur comment connecter le plus grand nombre possible de personnes à Internet, comment leur permettre d'entrer dans l'ère du digital. Et au niveau de mon association, ce que nous faisons, c'est surtout beaucoup de plaidoyers. Nous travaillons avec l'AIGF, à laquelle j'appartiens, pour construire des plaidoyers envers les pouvoirs publics. Donc, il s'agit pour nous, si on parle de connectivité, de déterminer les facteurs qui vont permettre de connecter le plus de personnes possible. Et ces facteurs, c'est créer un environnement favorable. Déjà, dans les défis qui vont se présenter, il y a l'énergie. Alors, nous allons construire des plaidoyers pour que les politiques publiques s'intéressent à la question énergétique afin que les opérateurs télécoms aillent dans les zones qui sont les moins favorisées. Également, nous allons construire des plaidoyers pour que il y ait de la sécurité dans toutes les zones, parce que vous savez que les investissements sont lourds. Et si on va dans les zones où il n'y a pas de sécurité, il est clair que il n'y aura pas, personne n'ira là-bas et les populations seront livrées à eux-mêmes. Donc, il nous faut signaler, nous, quels sont les facteurs qui peuvent permettre de créer un environnement favorable à l'expansion de l'Internet, à l'expansion du digital dans les communautés. Également, il y a la question des équipements TIC. Vous savez que pour tout ce qui est terminaux, lorsque la fiscalité est pesante, les utilisateurs ne peuvent pas acquérir les terminaux. Or, sans terminal, on ne peut pas accéder à l'Internet. On ne peut pas avoir de connectivité. Et donc, à ce niveau-là, il faut construire des plaidoyers pour pouvoir permettre de revoir la fiscalité à ce niveau. Également, il y a la fiscalité sur la connexion Internet. Donc, nous, notre rôle, c'est attirer surtout attirer les regards, attirer l'attention des pouvoirs publics et des autres parties prenantes sur le cadre favorable qu'il faut créer pour amener la connectivité jusqu'aux plus petits villages. Également, nous avons des actions de renforcement de capacité, nous menons des actions de formation, de sensibilisation pour que quand même, même si on n'a pas accès à la connectivité, qu'on sache de quoi il s'agit. Et lorsqu'on y aura accès, au moins on est déjà informé, on est déjà formé. Et notre action concerne aussi bien le grand public que les entreprises du secteur privé et l'administration publique. Parce que même si les citoyens, eux, sont connectés et que l'administration a encore des problèmes de connectivité, il est clair que vous n'aurez pas du tout les résultats escomptés en termes de profit qu'on peut tirer du digital. Donc, voilà de manière résumée notre action. Merci.
Merci bien. Excellent words. Thank you very much about the importance of inclusion, the fiscal issues, equipment, and basically how we can get more connectivity through some collaboration. The next speaker up is Ms. Lydienne Ntog from the Ministry of Posting Telecommunication in Cameroon. Lydienne, over to you for a minute.
Thanks for giving me the floor. Hello, everyone. I'm very happy and grateful to be part of this panel to share some area points that we in Cameroon, we've been doing in order to bridge the gap of digital exclusion in our country since the pandemic. Because actually, as it was said before, we had so many, our governments, most of our African governments found it difficult to act accordingly to the needs of the population before we were having this pandemic. But after the pandemic, we've noticed that in some area points, the governments have started working, seeing the need to react and to do more than what they were doing already in terms of infrastructure, in terms of access, in order to be able to connect the unconnected. Actually, we noticed that at the level of education, where we saw many children from rural areas not going to school and not being able to be connected with others, the healthcare system was not available for the rural areas, and the product supplies, the agricultural sector was facing difficulties. It wasn't possible to have food in towns because the transport was not available, transportation was not available. So because of that, our government, for example, they're putting in place actions and working with international organizations to look for solutions. And I think that is a good point that COVID brought to our African nations, where it is difficult to discuss and to put in, on the table issues that are really important. So, and because of it, we noticed that the policies have to be reframed, because the policies that were that were that are in place in our countries are very obsolete and they don't consider the new the changes of the on internet the new world that we are running into. So it became an urgent matter to try to transform and to accelerate the transformation, digital transformation of our countries. So I think that actually from what has been done already and what is still being, what our governments are putting in place as policies, it is therefore not all, it is enough. And we can still do better because most of the time we at the government level, we act or without the concern and the consideration of the local, of the populations, or of those that are using these services, we take decisions without putting them on the without considering their views, and that is what we are working on in Cameroon, for example, for that the multi-post community telecenters that were existing already. And we are now trying to bring up a platform of discussion with other with various stakeholders in order to bring solutions to provide real solutions for the needs of the population in terms of internet, in terms of access, and what type of access is needed in which area, and what are the needs of the population, because this is important to consider the needs of the population before proposing policies that will impact or influence their lifestyle. So that is what I wanted to share a bit, because we are in Cameroon, for example, we were not having IGF for the past how many years we've been fighting, looking for ways to bring on the table of discussions. The civil society, they worked for it, they tried everything, they tried was not working. But since the COVID-19, I think our governments are seeing the necessity of bringing together every stakeholder in order to discuss and to find out solution in order to bridge the gap of this digital inclusion exclusion of some parts of the population, like the rural area, women, people with disabilities, and so on and so forth. So that is what I had to say about all this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And just a reminder, we're going through a list of speakers. We have about a minute for each speaker, and then we'll have a bit of a discussion, and then we'll open it up to the floor. So the next speaker is from the Haiti IGF, Stephanie Joseph, the chair of the Internet Society's Haiti. Over to you, Stephanie.
Bonjour à tous. Merci, Jean. Je vais faire ma présentation en français parce que je vais pouvoir mieux m'exprimer. Je ne sais pas si tout le monde m'entend bien. Et en fait, je suis contente de pouvoir participer à l'IGF et d'avoir aussi l'occasion de discuter sur ce point qui est assez important pour nous. Comment on peut faciliter la connexion, surtout les gens et dans les zones rurales, dans les zones rurales, parce que ici en Haïti, pour nous-mêmes, c'est un défi. OK, mais maintenant, avec l'Internet Society du chapitre haïtien, on a eu une enquête pour pouvoir une idée comment ça fonctionne, l'Internet ou la connexion de l'Internet sur le territoire national. On a fait une enquête, on a eu les données et maintenant, à partir de ces données, on va pouvoir travailler pour savoir les zones les mieux et en fait les zones les plus reculées et qui n'ont pas vraiment accès pour savoir comment on va procéder pour arriver à ce que ces gens aient accès à l'Internet. Et puis, il y a les formations des gens aussi qu'on va posséder. Il faut qu'on ait des professionnels en TIC qui sont capables d'implémenter des réseaux communautaires en Haïti et comme ça, on va pouvoir faciliter et l'accès d'Internet avec les gens ruraux. Et je ne vais pas m'étaler trop parce qu'on a les discussions à faire. Donc, merci et puis, donc, on attend qu'on ait des questions pour les débats, tout ça. Merci.
Merci à vous. The next speaker we have is from Moldova. I had the pleasure of living there for 2 years. Mrs. Galina Klimov, Executive Director, the Alliance of Organizations of People with Disabilities, Republic of Moldova. Over to you, Galina.
Hello to everybody, and it's opportunity. It's a good opportunity, important opportunity for us as a representative of civil society organization from Moldova to participate at the EGF 2021 edition and to present the problems concerning connectivity and digitalization and at the national level. Our network, national network that include 53 civil society organizations promote and advance CRPD implementation for rights for the person with disabilities in Republika Moldova. And accessibility, it's one of our strategical goal of our alliance. In Moldova lives about 177,000 of persons with disabilities, that which represent 6.7% of entire population of the country. And people with disabilities are the most vulnerable category in country, and most of them live in rural areas where employment opportunities are extremely low, social infrastructures undeveloped, and which negatively influence the quality of life of these people. The pandemic period accentuated the vulnerability of people with disabilities by limiting access to education, medical, social, and other public services. The problem of access to support services is also current outside the pandemic, because the physical environment, public transportation, and informational environment are not adapted, and people with disabilities have no resources to purchase the devices and internet services. Our pandemic experience has also highlighted solutions to ensure continued support for people with disabilities. I will present several experience of our civil society organizations that supported the social services in order to digitalization these services. The uses of telemedicine method also. If talking about the policies, strategies, I will propose several solutions for continuous support in any part of the country of person from the all vulnerable groups. It can be included in national and local policies, the measure as a digitalization of services, presentation of web information in easy to understand, in easy to read format. Insurance the person from the vulnerable groups with connection to internet services and communication equipment, because these devices and services are pretty expensive for them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Galina. We thank you very much. Next up is from the Colombian IGF, a well-known person to many of us, Julian Casas Buenas from Colnodo. Julian, over to you.
Thank you very much, Jane. During the discussions on access and inclusion, we believe that there has been taking place in multiple spaces, including this session of NRIs. And show us that it's relevant to continue working from the IGF to find alternatives to connect the unconnected by seeking inclusive, affordable, and accessible solutions. In all these events, multiple models are presented to reduce the digital divide by connecting the unconnected, especially in rural and underserved areas. During our Internet Governance Forum in Colombia this year, we had the opportunity to have a panel on access and inclusion with the participation of the Inter-American Telecommunication Commission, CITEL, the Communication Regulation Commission in Colombia, the National Spectrum Agency, members of the community, and also a representative from the Dynamic Spectrum Alliance. And with all these discussions, we reflect that we must then move from formulating proposals to implementing them in the shortest time possible to help bridge the digital divide and connect the unconnected. It has been a long time in Colombia, more than 25 years since internet arrived to our country, and still we have a broad community, especially in rural areas, not connected. So this discussion was also taken into account the document produced by CITEL of best practices for bringing the digital divide by connecting the unconnected in underserved rural areas, where they recognize that the digital transformation requires a focus on people and not only in the deployment of network, and also long-term resources, policies, and regulation must be guaranteed by concrete projects that always include technological appropriation for citizens. And we have also a comments from the other stakeholders that I hope I will be able to share with you in the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Julian. And our next speaker is from France, the France IGF. It's Mrs. Claire Popinou, the chair of Éclairement. Over to you, Claire.
Hello, everyone. Claire-Mélanie Popinou, board member of Internet Society France, specializing in education and director at Ministry of Justice. But today I will speak on my behalf. Remote areas are not only islands, rural territories. There are territories with constraints, for example, privation of liberty, sickness, handicaps. Those territories can be hospital or jails. Today, I will speak about jails. In France, penitentiary system is a public system. 2009 law regarding the penitentiary system provides for a framework for two equivalent missions, one regarding security, of course, and one regarding insertion through formation, work, education. And a law just enacted in November strengthens the possibility to work in jails. Among those penitentiary structures, there are two categories of people, convicted people and people waiting to be judged or not definitely convicted. So why are those areas not really connected? First of all, jails are places where security needs to be upheld. There are indeed security reasons. The internet allows communications that should not be allowed and access to people or things that should not be accessed. But why, nonetheless, is it important to connect inmates to give them access to the internet? First of all, few facts about inmates to understand the context and the issues. A majority of them have no diploma. And moreover, a large number of them encounter a form of illiteracy. But inmates are citizens, and we cannot deny their rights. Inmates are citizens, and they will go out, and we have to work with them regarding their reintegration. So when you bring together those realities, what you obtain is that the internet is part of the problem and is part of the solution. I explain. How do you clearly want to understand and use the internet when you are illiterate? Yet, the internet is crucial, you know that, so I cut it. How do we connect inmates? How do we procure them access to the internet? The issue is to not stay on a technical level, but make internet be understood and used in interest of the people is another thing. To educate people is in the same time to fight hate speech, fake news, to allow people not to be a victim of scam or whatever misadventure on internet. For example, a chapter led by Internet Society France regarding the elderly and their uses of internet has shown the necessity to reinforce capacity and accompany. The true goal here is to educate people and to use the internet like a valuable way in order to create a future for the inmates, a proper future, I mean, especially with a valuable job. Two facts, again, professional skills regarding internet, for example, programmation, knowing algorithm, is a valuable skill outside the jail to find a job. And so there is a real need in France for these skills. And a statistic, very important, when an inmate follows a professional action in jail, formation, work, the risk of recidivism is no more of 50%, but decreases at 33%. This is really significant. So the internet is the present, but it's still the future and a true opportunity for inmates. What is done today, I will be short. There is first an ongoing effort to connect technically all the penitentiary structure through a program, numérique en détention in French, digital in jails, with the help of ATIGIP. This is an agency who aims to develop the solutions for insertion through work information, and which is depending of Ministry of Justice. There is different structures and initiatives regarding the internet in jail. For example, Webforce 3 is a school with teaching programmation for adults who encounter difficulty in the work field, even adults with disabilities. Internet Society France has followed its implementation in jails to learn and communicate about the difficulties and the opportunity to teach digital skills in this context. You can find a video on the Internet Society France website. And for another example, Code Phoenix is an NGO and a structure which forms and offers works in the field of programmation. For example, the website of the agency I talked knew about at Egypt was made by inmates. Next step is to generalize the connectivity and to make the public understand that because internet is part of everyday life, you can't cut off any of citizens from this area and knowledge. Finally, the different projects I had mentioned had shown the importance of a collaborative approach as well as involving the different stakeholders to tackle the key issue of insertion, particularly for the people in remote area and in jails. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Claire. That was a very interesting aspect of this with respect to jails and connectivity. Thank you very much. It helps with digital inclusion for sure. I'm going to change things up a little bit. We have about 5 minutes to have a discussion for any observations from any of our speakers. With respect to what drives access in the rural remote areas and what's smart to do and how. So we've got 5 minutes for that, and then we'll have 10 minutes for an open floor between speakers and participants on the issues presented. And then I'm going to do a speed round on voluntary commitments and recommendations from others. So the first issue up now for 5 minutes, do any of our speakers want to reflect on what was said during the open floor? And let us know more about what you think about driving access in rural and remote areas and what's smart to do and how. And if you can keep your comments very short, we don't have translation in the room. And what we'll be doing is going back to the transcript and we'll be using that to create the record. But if we could take 2 or 3 or 4 speakers, what would you do to drive access in rural and remote areas? What is smart or intelligent to do and how would you do it? Just some short thoughts. Who would like to start? I see Julian has his hand up, and so I will go to Julian, yeah?
Thank you, Jane. Well, from the discussions that I mentioned in our Colombian IGF, I will highlight to promote the use of universal service funds for connectivity projects in rural areas, encourage discussion on the analysis of fiscal measures that favor connectivity. Connectivity in rural areas usually is more than 100 in excess of in urban areas, so it's very expensive. The appropriation of technology that was mentioned also, it's very important as well to the promotion of connectivity in these areas. And also to encourage the participation of small and community network operations, as well of having flexible and simple spectrum access frameworks, and encourage the implementation of community networks as an alternative with sustainable models and quality connectivity with access to universal communications for funds for initial deployment and connectivity subsidies.
Wonderful, thank you, Julian. I also see that Samuel, you have your hand up, and after Samuel, we're going to Gertrude. So if you can, just a quick minute of observation.
All right, thank you very much. From an African perspective, one thing that's very key for us is the fact that even as we drive connectivity in rural areas, we need to look at the spending power, the economic power of the persons who live in these rural areas. Because yes, you may drive connectivity, you may complete last mile connectivity, but if people do not have the economic means to pay for the data to connect because of the economic circumstances and because of the extremely high cost of data on the African continent, it becomes an inhibitive factor. So you realize you've done connectivity, you've achieved connectivity, however, usage is still very low. And so one thing that we will need to look at is how Europe and the rest of the world can support cheaper, affordable data onto the African continent. That way, when you drive connectivity, you can as well drive usage, because connectivity without usage is actually meaningless. Again, another thing I think we should look at is how to integrate traditional services that people are used to build an appetite for digital inclusion. So things like using the old post office, which people are very familiar with, the older generation is familiar with. These post offices have become redundant in many local communities. So can we convert these post offices into digital centers of excellence, where persons can now go there and access internet and have access to e-learning tools? Those are things that we need to look at and begin to integrate. Thank you.
Thank you. Excellent points. We have three more people with their hands up that were our speakers before. So I'd love you to give us just a minute each. I'm going to turn to Gertrude, Lidiane, and Galina. So first over to you, Gertrude, for a minute.
Merci beaucoup. Je voudrais revenir sur le problème de la fiscalité parce que c'est un réel problème pour les consommateurs. Il est clair que si on ne parle pas de fiscalité de développement et que c'est juste une fiscalité qu'on applique sur le secteur IT, tout simplement parce que c'est un secteur en pleine croissance et donc il y a de plus en plus de taxes dessus. Chaque année, on invente de nouvelles taxes parce que c'est un secteur en pleine croissance. Il est clair que les consommateurs auront de plus en plus de mal, quand bien même on irait vers une extension de tout ce qui est réseau télécom, même si la connectivité existe, mais que ça reste cher, il est clair qu'on n'aura pas atteint notre objectif. Donc, pour moi, il faut travailler sur la fiscalité, revoir la fiscalité de telle sorte qu'on puisse aider le plus grand nombre possible de personnes à se connecter sur Internet. Parce que tout à l'heure, mon prédécesseur a évoqué la question du coût de la data, mais le coût de la data dépend aussi de la fiscalité. Le coût des terminaux dépend de la fiscalité. Et si on n'aborde pas cette question-là, on n'aura rien fait du tout. Pour moi, c'est un impératif, la fiscalité. Et à côté de cela, la question, trouver des solutions pour fournir de l'énergie, pour fournir de l'électricité dans les zones rurales, parce que sans électricité, pas d'Internet. Ça, c'est clair. Donc, il faudrait également qu'on pense à des solutions simples de fourniture d'électricité. Pourquoi ne pas développer les énergies durables? Mais là encore, les pays les moins avancés ont des problèmes pour pouvoir développer des programmes d'énergie durable. Et c'est toute une réflexion à mener sur le sujet. Merci.
Merci. So a lot about fiscalité and development and energy, l'achanie and the connectivity costs and data. So thank you very much. So Lydia, over to you. And after Lydia, Galina. So Lydia, 1 minute. Un moment, s'il vous plaît. Une minute, s'il vous plaît. So Lydia.
Alors, merci. D'accord, okay. Merci beaucoup de me passer la parole parce que ce qui a été dit, effectivement, il faut utiliser les réseaux communautaires. Les postes, les bureaux de poste existent, les peuvent être utilisés également à dessein. Je pense également que nous avons un problème d'infrastructure qu'on devrait amener dans les zones rurales. Les plus aux besoins des populations. En réalité, si on commence à chercher à mettre en place des infrastructures qui ne sont pas appropriées, qui ne seront pas utilisées, ça ne vaut vraiment pas la peine. Je pense que dans des infrastructures de petit niveau, pour certaines localités, serait également un moyen de leur donner accès à l'Internet. On a parlé tout à l'heure également de l'énergie solaire. À certains endroits, on devrait pouvoir adapter en fonction des besoins des localités et des populations. Le service que les offres qu'on pourrait leur apporter. Donc, je pense toujours que la stratégie du bottom-up est la meilleure stratégie pour s'assurer que les besoins en termes de numérique de la population est répondu en réalité en fonction des priorités et des capacités des populations.
And if we could ask Nazar to mute, that would be great. And thank you very much, Lydia. You were discussing the importance of energy, connectivity, and as well as costs. Okay, so we'll go over to Galina for a minute, and then we're going to open it up to the floor, and I'll explain how that's going to work in a minute. But Galina, for you now, 1 minute, please.
Thank you very much. I will say that we as a civil society organization with our partners that promote us to participate today at the EGF session, we will act together in partnership with the central authorities in order to do an assessment about all the web page of different types of services, social services, educational services, web page of different institutions that are used by person with disabilities, by persons from the vulnerable groups, and in order to know what kind of resources we need to plan to budget to adjust them to respond to the person with disabilities needs. And I hope that we will have openness of our government, parliament, to promote the changes in the e-government strategies in order to include these resources to adjust all the web page of public services in order to be accessibility for all population. Thank you.
Thank you, Galina. And that was a really important point you're making about an appeal to government to make their public website and pages accessible. Accessibility is a really important issue with respect to digital inclusion and in the pandemic for bringing people even closer together from the rural and remote areas. We have about 15 minutes left. And what we'd like to do is open the floor now between the speakers and the participants in the room on the issues that the speakers have presented. We can take about 8 minutes for this, and I'll try and keep track of time. But let's keep the comments really crisp, if we can, 30 seconds to a minute with your questions. So I will ask for some help with the remote friends. I see hands up. So I'll try and facilitate this the best I can. This is going to be fun. So I see that there are some hands up from the remote hub in Dhaka in Bangladesh. Yeah. So Dhaka, what question do you have for one of our participants?
Thank you so much. Is I am audible? Can you guys hear me? Hello.
We can hear you. Yes, you're loud and clear. Bravo.
So much. Undoubtedly, this is a very wonderful session and an informative session by our genius speakers. So can you kindly enlighten me about the measures to promote policy network meaningful access in remote areas? Moreover, how can we make this safer for kids and teenagers? Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you for keeping your question short. Who among our panelists here would like to address that question? How do you create a better policy network? And how do you help with good safety for kids? So that's a very important question. But who would like to take a go at that? How about Julian? Or I know you're working closely with different authorities, maybe even Samuel, but Julian, any thoughts on that?
I can comment briefly about our reflections and has to deal with eliminate barriers to network deployment, also sharing infrastructure to reduce rates in rural areas, and that regulatory barriers are not adjusted just to rural areas, because sometimes when we want to implement community networks, for instance, we have to follow rules that are designed mainly for urban areas. And related to protecting the child, in our case, we have governmental initiatives that create a series of materials that can be used to prevent abuse for child and have a good and good practices to prevent child to be abused or used or contact by organizations or people that want to create, for instance, a child pornography. But there are a lot of initiatives from governments to prevent that, and also from private organizations.
Thank you very much, Julian and Team DACA. That's a good answer for you. And Julian comes from Colnodo. If you want to reach out to him, I'm sure he could put his email in the chat. You guys could chat more. I do notice that Osvaldo, who's in the room, I believe, or maybe online, had his hand up for quite some time. Do you have a question for our participants, Osvaldo?
Yes, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to collaborate. In Dominican Republic, we have an entity in charge of rural communities, which is managed by the government. And they do not only include the opportunities for people to connect, but also some contents about programming languages, robotics, 3D printing. It is important to connect with them via the public services, but also to enjoy what community can get with a content local to their needs. Is there any of the cases presented included the collaboration from the government in a multi-stakeholder way, as I think we are doing in Dominican Republic? It's just to know how deep it could be helpful for include the government in these policies. Thank you.
Great question. Any of our speakers, a question about including government
in
content? Voila, go for it.
All right, so in Ghana, what we have currently going with the Ministry of Communications is a joint partnership with the MNOs, the mobile network operators, in rural communities where it's not feasible, economically feasible for them to go in and build the mast and give connectivity. What we've done is we've decided to have a partnership using our Universal Access Fund, which is called the Ghana Investment Fund for Electronic Communications, GIFET. We use that as a basis to go in. Currently, we're rolling out 2,016 sites across rural Ghana to ensure that the cost of the sites are actually borne by the Universal Access Funds to be able to provide that connectivity at very low rates and low cost, both to the end users and to the MNOs who would not want to put in the initial capex or capital expenditure to set up those sites. Again, on the first question of child pornography or child protection, in Ghana, what we have is we've ratified the Budapest Convention and then the Malabo Convention. And what those conventions do is they've imposed a certain responsibility on the state to ensure that we have clean cyber hygiene to protect our kids. And we've got a cybersecurity month in Ghana where we focus a lot dealing with the schools. We have clubs set up in schools that are actually working with these children and using them as ambassadors to be able to identify possible groomers on the internet and report those guys. The ultimate, I think that.
Oops, we lost you there, Samuel. You had a really good point about working with companies.
Can you hear me now?
Again, you had a point you were making about groomers.
Yes, so what we're saying is we have the Cybersecurity Authority, which has been set up in Ghana now, which is actively working with focal persons in schools to look and identify in kids' chat rooms and all of that for possible groomers who are looking to groom these young kids and exploit them for whatever purposes. So it's a collaborative effort between teachers, between parents, between schools, and even the students themselves, for them to be able to identify the potential of groomers in online.
Excellent, thank you. We're taking questions from the floor, and we have 10 minutes left, right? So I think, go for it. Yes, you'd like to say something?
Yeah, so I wanted to add a bit more on partnerships with the government, because the way we do it in Tanzania, most people believe that partnership with the government could be in form of funding, but for us, how we do it, it's in form of policy change. How are the policies working not against us, but for us in terms of connectivity in rural areas, but also our partnership with the government, it's since they are the ones in control of the schools and most of the governance in the rural areas. So we have to get permits in working with communities in general. So partnerships with the government are important because we cannot bypass the government, and they're the ones with the strategies for digital advancements in the countries. So apart from partnerships with the government, also we are trying to see how we can have partnerships with different branches of the government, not the central, but also local and regional governments. Also, we are trying to see how partnerships with civil societies, partnership with academic institutions, because we don't believe in only in working and as isolated. We believe in working as a combination of everyone coming together into building what we call connectivity. So for us, access is not the end. We try to see how different partners can come in bringing about content, skills, devices, because only providing access is not the end. So yeah.
Thank you. This is a really important point. What I'm going to do now is that we've got about, I think I'd like if you could put your points in the chat. That way we'll have them recorded.
I don't have access to the chat, but okay.
Okay. Could you go for 30 seconds? Because we do have to wrap up and we will disappear. Yes.
Okay, so go ahead. My name is Nema Lugangira. I'm a member of parliament from Tanzania. And I just wanted to quickly highlight that it's equally important when we're doing this policy advocacy and trying to get connectivity to also include the politicians at all levels, legislators in parliament, but also at local communities. And also, you know, in all of this, we need to focus on the digital literacy, because if people are not well informed and they don't know how to use these services, then it will be challenging to achieve any of the great things that have been said here today. So much as we're doing all of this, let us also remember capacity building for the politicians, for the legislators at all levels. Thank you.
Right on. No, I love that. And working with politicians at all levels is highly important. And thank you very much, because we need that openness with our policymakers, which is highly critical for change. Thank you all. We're going to do a bit of a speed round. And by speed round, I mean 30 seconds for our speakers that started out. And Abdullah Jalil, could you put your question in the chat? That way we can record it. 30 seconds to 45 seconds for each of our speakers. And I'm going to go in the order that you spoke. So starting with Catherine, down to France with Claire. So each of you will have 30 seconds to 45 seconds to give us a recommendation. So this means that it's a tweet almost. If you had 140 words, what would you say your action point would do with respect to commitments that can be made, recommendations? You've got a parliamentarian there in the room. She's listening to you and she can help you make change. What is it you would recommend? So this is going to go quickly. So it's like a live tweet. Catherine, what would be your live tweet for a recommendation? You have 30 seconds. Go.
Okay, Jane, I'm not so good with tweets, but alternative for local limitations, because I believe there are a lot of limitations that are there in the local communities. So what alternative are we using in terms of connectivity? Are we going for the one size fit all, or are we going for a customized solution for each community? The second one will be behavioral change, because most people in rural areas do not trust the internet. So how are we make sure that we are building trust? How are we making sure that they are able to come online and feel safe and feel that it's a place that they belong? How are they seeing value in the internet? So I think behavioral change is important, because at the end of the day, we could go and provide access and everything, but then change of behavior and change of mindset, if it's not there, then people won't use the access that we are providing. So thank you.
Excellent. That gets to the point also of digital literacy and inclusion. Bravo. Ghana, you're up. Samuel, you have 30 seconds to 45 seconds. Over to you. Oopsie, and we can't hear you if you get closer to your microphone. Lovely.
Can you hear me, please? Can you hear
me? We can. Bravo. You got it.
For me, I think a key issue here is how we can improve or utilize existing traditional infrastructure to deliver digital means. So the old post office, the old community centers, how do we convert this into digital access points for persons in rural communities? Again, in converting that and giving them an appetite for digital inclusion, how do we make it affordable, looking at the economic circumstances of these people? And then the last point will be, how do we make it safe? What kind of cyber etiquettes can we introduce to them to make sure that even as we build the appetite, even as we give them the platforms, they are safe online?
Brilliant. Love it. Conversion, affordability, safety. Côte d'Ivoire, Gertrude, you're up. 30 seconds, 30 secondes.
Merci beaucoup. Alors, pour moi, la première chose serait de renforcer le partenariat public-privé pour développer le service universel Télécom TIC. Donc, la première des choses, c'est de renforcer ce partenariat. La seconde des choses, c'est également de soutenir les efforts du secteur privé. Le public doit soutenir, donc l'administration publique doit soutenir les efforts du secteur privé, parce que ce sont les privés qui ont eu l'initiative de déployer l'Internet, de déployer le digital. Il faut soutenir leurs efforts et non pas brider leurs efforts, donc réduire leurs efforts en mettant des taxes trop élevées. Et la troisième chose, c'est qu'il faut pouvoir continuer le renforcement de capacité au niveau des populations. Parce qu'en parlant de la protection des enfants en ligne, il y a d'abord tout ce qui est formation, sensibilisation et renforcement de capacité. Si on ne sait pas quoi faire, on ne pourra pas continuer, on ne pourra pas protéger les enfants. Donc, il faut apprendre à les protéger. Merci.
Merci. Partnerships, fiscalité et capacité. OK, bravo. Cameroon, Lydia, Ms. Lydia, you have 30 to 40 seconds. Sorry for the shortness, but over to you.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Lady Jarma.
Lydia is up from our colleague.
I am not up, but I'm hearing somebody speaking behind.
Yeah, go ahead, Lydia. It's over, okay. Over
so,
to you.
For me, there is no universal miracle solution to end digital exclusion and to provide access. I think the main thing is to continue the discussions the way we are already doing them with all stakeholders, making sure that the governments are always not pointed as if they are only responsible of what is going wrong, but bringing them to be able to accept our ideas. It is the best way to bring lasting solutions. Also, for me, is to develop local contents. I think that we have this problem. We are using others' tools from other people. We cannot, in Africa, for example, if we continue using things that are coming from others and not trying to develop our startups, helping them to improve the quality of content they produce for the population, they won't be able to use anything won't be able to be interested. So adapt the content to the needs.
Thank you very much. Wonderful. Haiti, 30 seconds. Stephanie.
Merci. En fait, pour moi, la première chose, c'est que l'État aide les entités publiques et privées à faciliter l'infrastructure pour pouvoir arriver vers les gens ruraux et puis comme ça, avoir l'électricité parce que sans l'électricité, il n'y a pas l'Internet. Et la plus grande vision de l'ISOC, c'est qu'il y a un Internet pour tout le monde. Donc, pour que cette mission soit vraiment atterrie, donc il faut qu'il y ait vraiment l'infrastructure pour faciliter le travail et ensuite nous autres aider à développer des réseaux communautaires dans les zones rurales qui va faciliter l'accès à l'Internet pour tout le monde. Et pour les enfants, il faut qu'il y ait vraiment... Les parents aussi doivent impliquer, comme aider les enfants à savoir... En fait, ça commence dans la famille, ce que c'est vraiment l'Internet, comment ils peuvent utiliser, quels sont les dangers, et ensuite les parties prenantes à créer beaucoup plus de contenu mieux pour les enfants, comme ça ils n'ont pas à chercher à avoir d'accès avec d'autres contenus qui ne sont pas appropriés pour les enfants.
Merci. OK, Moldova, we have about, can you give us about 10 words? What would you do to make change?
I will say that we will create and develop intersectoral and interinstitutional partnerships, including persons with disabilities, with different disabilities, to promote the best solution for the accessible digital and internet spaces.
Thank you. Bravo. Colombia, 10 words.
Encourage the implementation of community networks with the support from Universal Communication Funds for the initial deployment and connectivity subsidized. And okay.
That's a good tweet. France, over to you, Claire, to wrap us up. Partnerships are important, and if you can give us 30 words.
Developing technical connectivity, yes, of course. Developing educational connectivity, yes, above all, in a multi-stakeholder approach. We have to involve all stakeholders in a collaborative way to foster insertion and digital inclusion of inmates and of everybody. Thank you.
Merci bien. Thank you very much, ISOC France and Claire, who's in the government. You have heard an amazing session of speakers. I made them talk very quickly to try and get more in, but I want to thank everyone in the room. I want to thank everyone online. This was brilliant. You have some great words that you've given us here about partnerships, public-private partnerships, working with government, working with community networks, trying to wire jails, looking at digital access and accessibility. Thank you very much, Anya. Sorry for going a little bit over, but this was an excellent session and it's inspiring to see what you all are doing around the world. Thank you. Anya, over to you.
Just a big thank you to an excellent moderator. We have to subscribe to having Jane every year moderating at least one NRI session, if not all. Thank you very much to all the co-organizers, all the speakers. It's been a pleasure to work with you throughout the year. And we, of course, continue and next year, the next year's IGF, we're hosting another set of sessions. Thank you very much. And of course, before I forget, very important, huge thank you to our rapporteurs, Ines and Lily. They're here physically. They don't have an easy task because you've shared so many complex issues, but we're looking forward to read your reports. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good day.